19:319, let every heart rejoice and sing. Let every heart rejoice and sing, let choral anthems rise, ye aged men and children bring to God your sacrifice. For he is good, the Lord is good, and kind are all his ways. With songs that honor sounding loud, the Lord Jehovah prays. While the rocks and the rills, while the vales and the hills, a glorious anthem raise. Let each prolong the grateful song and the God of our fathers praise. And the God of our fathers praise. He bids the sun to rise and set in heaven. His power is known, and earth subdued to him shall yet bow low before his throne. For he is good, the Lord is good, and kind are all his ways. With songs and honor sounding loud, the Lord Jehovah praise. While the vales and the hills a glorious anthem raise, let each prolong the grateful song and the God of our fathers praise. And the God of our fathers praise. Our next song is number 427. 427. Praise the Lord. Let's sing the first, third, and fourth verses. 1, 3, and 4 of this song, Praise the Lord. 427.
Praise the Lord, ye heavens, adore him. Praise him, angels in the high. Sun and moon rejoice before him. Praise him, all ye stars of light. Hallelujah, amen.
If you would at this time mark number 696, 696. And the title of that, I didn't write it down. There's a fountain free, for those of you online. That's the title of the song, There's a Fountain Free. And before our scripture reading, if you would, after you've marked 696, turn over to number 232. We're going to sing all three verses, and then we'll sing the chorus after this. All three verses, and then the chorus. I will sing of my Redeemer and His wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross He suffered, from the curse to set me free. I will tell the wondrous story, how the lost is saved to save. In His boundless love and mercy, He's the ransom freely gave. I will sing of my Redeemer and His heavenly love to me. He from death to life hath brought me, Son of God with Him to be. I will sing of my Redeemer, with His blood He purchased me. On the cross He sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free.
Good morning. I will read three bits of scripture today. They're going to be from Psalm 30, verse 4, Psalm 97, verse 12, and 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18. For Psalm 30, verse 4, sing praise to the Lord, you saints of His, and give thanks at the remembrance of His holy name. For a second verse, from Psalm 97, verse 12, rejoice in the Lord, you righteous, and give thanks at the remembrance of His holy name. And our third verse, from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you.
Good morning. Add my welcome to all of you who are here. It's always good to see you all. And assuming that things are typical, we have some people joining us online. We're glad you decided to join us too. As you can tell by the slide there, I want to talk about Thanksgiving this morning. I mean, technically the day was a couple of days ago, but I think with gatherings and travel, it kind of flows over into the weekend. Who celebrates Thanksgiving? A lot of times we say, well, we celebrate Thanksgiving. It's not everybody in the world that celebrates Thanksgiving. But it's not just the U.S. Evidently, Canada does also. So it's a holiday of North America. O. Henry said it is the one day that is purely American. New York Times put it, they said, in a sense, it's the most American holiday after Independence Day. It's not always been that way that we had a Thanksgiving Day here in America. Typically, history credits the Pilgrims of Plymouth, Massachusetts for originating it. 1621, Governor William Bradford of Plymouth Colony proclaimed 3 days of prayer and thanksgiving. But really, Virginia could say that they did it earlier. In 1620, the settlers in Berkeley 100, Virginia, on the James River, decreed that the day of our ship's arrival shall be yearly and perpetually kept as a holy day of thanksgiving to Almighty God. I want to share with you some of the quotes through the years as we have established this into an annual holiday. What I want you to notice is, to whom are they giving thanks? They're giving thanks to God. I think as the country kind of changes its flavor, changes the emphasis that we have, it's good to remind ourselves that originally, the ones who originated this country were extremely grateful to God. They had their gatherings, but it was not to the parade grounds that they gathered. It was to their church buildings. Eventually, it became an annual holiday, as I'll explain, but then I want to emphasize the fact that it's Thanksgiving to God. And if this nation was established not just to be a religious nation, this nation was established to be a Christian nation. Let me share with you a few of the quotes. In 1620, they had the Day of Thanksgiving. It was not until the next century, in 1789, that George Washington issued the Presidential Proclamation designating November 26th as a day for acknowledging with grateful heart the many signal favors of Almighty God. Signal is a word that we use in a different way now, but it means the very great favors that God has given to us. But it was not until the next century when Abraham Lincoln in 1863 issued a proclamation that did recognize and confess the presence of the Almighty Father and the power of his hand equally in these triumphs and in these sorrows. But again, not just the annual recognition of it, but to whom? It was recognition. It was a day of praise to God. It was to their religious meeting houses that they went. Those who settled this nation, they believed in God. And they believed that we were here, this nation was introduced to them, if you will, by the providence of God. And they worshiped God and they thanked God. They were not ashamed to thank God. They would have been ashamed not to thank God. Those proclamations by the Presidents Washington and Lincoln acknowledged God as the source of the blessings. And I want us to be clear, it was not to some generic God, not to some generic deity. It was, in fact, the God of the Bible. And more specifically, not just to the God of Abraham. It was specifically to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. I think it's good to remind ourselves from time to time, we were established to be a Christian nation. In 1606, the first charter of Virginia specified the Virginia colony should advance the Christian faith. 1620, the Mayflower Compact began by declaring that the Pilgrims' objectives were to advance the glory of God and the Christian faith. 1643, the Fundamental Orders of Connecticut documented a confederation together to maintain and preserve the liberty and the purity of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, which we now profess. 1643, authors of the Constitution of the New England Confederation declared that they came to America. Notice the purpose statement here. They came to America to advance the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. And then in 1820, Daniel Webster wrote that the foundation of our nation was the divine light of the Christian religion and warned, let us not forget the religious character of our origin. I think a lot of people have forgotten the religious character of our origin. I think there are a lot of people today who are opposing. They're trying to help us forget the religious origin. I don't think we need to do that. We don't want to do that. Woe be it unto those who forget. And I would say woe be it unto us if we let them forget. Those who would try to rewrite our history and make us some religion-neutral nation. Now, gratefully, we grew up with a tolerance for all kinds of religions, but let us never forget, we were established to be a Christian nation. It was meant to be a Christian nation. We shouldn't have to feel like second-class citizens if we bring up our Christianity, if we proclaim our Christianity, if we share our Christianity. Some of our founders affirmed that that was the reason for being for this great nation. So how right and how appropriate it is that we join those who, through the centuries, have given thanks to God. But we know that not everybody is willing to give thanks to God. So I thought we would talk for a few moments this morning about who would not be grateful to God for the many blessings that we have. And as we look at the different categories of people who would not be grateful to God, we want to look at ourselves. Is it possible, maybe much to our surprise, that at times we might fall into one of those categories? Who will not be grateful to God? Number one, the skeptic will not be grateful to God. And we talk about two different kinds of skeptics. There is the one kind of skeptic, it's the atheist. The atheist is the one who positively affirms that there is no God. How could he be thankful to God? What kind of a confusion would he have to express thanks to a God that he believes does not exist? It would be sheer hypocrisy. So the first person who would not give thanks to God is one form of skeptic, and that's the atheist. Well, there's another form of skeptic, and that's the agnostic. The Greek word gnosis means to know. You put the A in front of it, and it's a negative. So the agnostic is a person who does not know. He would not say there's not a God. He would not say there is a God. He would say, well, I just don't know. If he does not confidently affirm that there is not a God, but he is skeptical about God's existence, that person would not want to offer thanks to God. How could he offer to a God thanks to a God he's not sure exists? So whether a person is an atheist or an agnostic, there is the absence of a recognition of a belief in God. And there are consequences to that. The Bible warns about it. A failure to recognize the existence of God, the Bible warns us, is a quick path to ingratitude. If you don't believe in God, you're not going to be grateful. Paul wrote to the Romans about those who refuse to acknowledge God for who he is. Paul says, because they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful. And in a minute, I want to make a clear distinction. There are people who believe in a lot of forms, maybe sometimes even superstitiously. They believe in some form of power that is out there. But we need to make a clear distinction between just believing in something and believing in the one true God that the Bible tells us about. So those who are uncertain will not thank God. They are heading themselves down the dreary path of ingratitude. Could that include any of us? I think we would quickly say, no, we believe in God. That couldn't include any of us. But I think we ought to be careful how quickly we answer. We believe in some sort of deity. Do we really believe in the God of the Bible as he's described in the Bible? There are many, and I've talked with them, who believe in some sort of God, but their concept of God, their concept of the deity they believe in, is something very different than the deity in the Bible. I've explained before you can tell by their language. They say, well, my God would never do this, or my God would never do that. When they find things in the Bible that they don't like, they're quick to judge them. We talked about in Bible class this morning. If we do not let God and his words judge us, sometimes we turn the tables. Sometimes we wind up judging God. If they say, my God would not condemn anyone to eternal punishment, they're saying that the God that's described in the Bible can't be right. That can't be a true God, because that God says things that they don't believe in. Or they might say, my God would not care if I married again after an improper divorce. My God would not want me to spend the rest of my life unmarried. Are they looking at the guidance that we have in God's word? Or are they deciding what they would like and allowing their thoughts to judge the God of the Bible? He said, my God would not care if I used one of those many addictive and harmful substances as long as I did it in my own house. They said, my God wouldn't do this, or my God would do that. And they're right to call him my God. He is their God. They've made him up. It's not the true God in the Bible. We know what that God wants us to do. We know what his instructions are. We know what his commands are. Those who are doing something different, it's a God that they've made up. And sometimes they've made him up because they're very self-willed. They are so self-willed that they have remade God according to their will. He has qualities and expectations that are very different than the God in the Bible. And that's a dangerous thing. People can delude themselves. They can use a lot of the right language about God. But if they're not talking about the God that's described in the Bible, they're not talking about the one true God in the universe. The one that they describe is not the God of the Bible. He has qualities and expectations The one in the Bible, we know what his qualities, we know what his expectations are. And those who believe in a God that does not have those qualities, they believe in a God that does not have those expectations, they're not believing in the one true God. And they really can't be grateful to the one true God, because the God that they believe in is very different than the one true God. The one true God is thanked and praised only when we first acknowledge him for who he is. And notice Paul says that in Romans. They need to acknowledge God and then to thank and praise him. So those who thank a distorted God, a made-up God, are not really giving thanks to the one true God of the universe. They are not really giving thanks to the God who is their creator. Another person who will not be grateful is the forgetful person. The forgetful person will not thank God. Before you can thank, you have to remember. Paul wrote to the Philippians, he says, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. If he does not have some remembrance of them, if he does not have some image of them in his brain, he's not really thanking that God. If Paul had not remembered those Philippians and all that they had done for him, he would not. He could not have been grateful. He could not have given thanks. When it comes to giving thanks to God, there are a lot of people, maybe I should say a lot of us, who from time to time have spiritual amnesia. Amnesia, and a physical amnesia, may be rare in our medical and in the things that we encounter medically. But I'm thinking that spiritual amnesia may not be all that rare. God's own people are very apt to suffer from this disease of spiritual amnesia because they've forgotten his past blessings. How appropriate for us is the admonition that the psalmist gives himself, Psalm 103, verse 2, Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. One man said, well, if you can't remember them all, at least try to make sure you don't forget all of them. When one forgets God's blessings, if we forget God's blessings, we can't be grateful for the blessings. And I saw a quote not too long ago that, you know, it's how quickly we forget. It's how quickly when we encounter a new crisis do we forget how God has brought us through the crisis in the past. We can be forgetful. We can forget the blessings God has given us. If we forget, we're not going to be thankful. Another person who will not be grateful to God is the self-sufficient person. One man, it was written as a joke. I don't know if it's a joke or a true story. He said, why should I be grateful to God for the food on my table? I was the one that plowed the ground. I was the one that planted the crop. I was the one that harvested the crop. Why should I be grateful to God for all of that? Well, did he create the seed? Did he create the water? Did he create the amazing process by which things grow? If we don't recognize the things that God does, if we think that we are taking care of all of our things ourselves, then why be grateful to God? If we are not grateful to God, then does that mean we think we're self-sufficient? And really, we have a classic example of that in the Bible. In Luke chapter 12, there was the farmer who was blessed with a great harvest. And of the man's harvest, it was the ground of a certain man, rich man, yielded plentifully. Well, that's great. Was this man about to praise God and recognize him for the great harvest that he said had? No, he wasn't. The farmer had other ideas. This is Luke 12, 16, and 18. But he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build greater barns. There I will store all my crops and all my goods. He thought he was self-sufficient. He thought he was in control of his future. His conclusion was, and I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease and drink and be merry. But that wasn't what happened, was it? The person who was arrogant, who was self-sufficient and arrogant toward God and his self-sufficiency, God said to him, fool, this night your soul will be required of you. And then whose will those things be that you have provided? He perhaps needed to hear the warning of Paul to Timothy. Command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who gives us richly all things to enjoy. The farmer was haughty. He boasted. He says, all of this is mine. All of this is my doing. I can take care of myself. I'm going to have all that I need for many years. God said, no, your soul is going to be required of you this night. The self-sufficient man is usually a proud man. A proud man is rarely grateful. And as I pondered all of this, being grateful requires some humility. How can I thank you for anything without first coming to the conclusion that you have provided something for me that I either could not or at least I was not providing for myself? Maybe the trouble that some people have in saying thank you, maybe the trouble that some people have in being grateful is because they have the haughtiness of self-sufficiency. If we don't believe that there are other people who can do things that are necessary for us or do things that are helpful to us, it's difficult to be grateful. At its core, thanksgiving is an act of humility. The proud, self-sufficient man has trouble being grateful because he has trouble being humble. The self-sufficient man is another one who will not give thanks to God. So unless you think you have done everything in your life all by yourself, then you owe some gratitude to somebody. And we ought to express that gratitude. Certainly we ought to be expressing our gratitude toward God. And if we think about it, there are probably some other people too. Not just God, but people. Who else will not be grateful to God? The greedy. He is too consumed with what he wants to be grateful for what he has. But when he gets the next thing, all of a sudden, that's not enough. Then he wants something else. The Bible tells us about these people. Solomon warns, Ecclesiastes 5:10, he who loves silver will not be satisfied with silver. Now he who loves abundance with increase. What a great warning that is. You know, there are two ways that we can learn things. One is we can just go through life making our own mistakes. How great it would be if we had some source of wisdom where we could learn things without having to make all the mistakes. Well, we do. And that source is the Bible. Solomon warns us, he who has silver will not be satisfied with silver. The people who are rich, are they satisfied with the amount of money that they have? I guess it's not impossible that somewhere somebody is, but a lot of them are not. They spend the rest of their life trying to make more. The greedy man is too busy coveting what he does not have to be thankful for what he does have. His covetousness makes him discontent. The writer of Hebrews draws exactly that same comparison, the same contrast between content and covetous. Hebrews 13:5, let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with what you have. If we're not content in our lives, maybe we need to look once again at our hearts. Are we not content because we are just dreaming up more things to want? The content are not covetous. The covetous are not content. And a lot of that's related to thankfulness. Daniel Defoe said, all of our discontents spring from the lack of thankfulness for what we have. Now that's a powerful statement. All of our discontents come from the lack of being thankful for what we have. That sounds good, but I think maybe he had it backwards. I think maybe it's more appropriate to say our lack of thankfulness comes from our discontents. If we are not content with the things that we have, if we're always wishing for something else, striving to have more, then we're not going to be grateful for what we have. If we're not grateful for what we have, then that lack of gratitude is going to spill over into discontent. The discontent is going to spill over into dissatisfaction. The greedy, covetous person will not be grateful to God because he does not feel gratitude at all. He is not grateful for what he has. He is ungrateful for the things he does not have. The greedy person will not be grateful to God. So, maybe we should be careful. Maybe we should not be too quick to say, well, we are grateful as we should be. When it comes to thankfulness toward God, we need to do more than just being grateful. You know, if we thought that was enough just to be grateful, then we think about the story of Jesus when he healed the men and only one of them came back to say thank you. He says, where are the rest of them? I think that's a very poignant story. Were they all grateful that they were healed of leprosy? One would conclude that they were. What was Jesus' criticism? His criticism was they did not come back to say thank you. I think maybe that would be a good lesson for us in all of our lives, in all aspects of our life, not just the religious part of our life. Are sometimes we negligent in saying thank you to people who do things for us? Carol does a lot for me, but I think she would tell you, I say thank you a lot. I'd be a terrible ingrate if I didn't. But aren't we that way in our, shouldn't we be that way in all of our lives? How many times a day does somebody do something for us? Are we really grateful? If we're really grateful, we would probably say so. God expects our gratitude to him, at least, to be expressed. Daniel 6:10, Daniel did. Daniel, he knelt down to his knees three times that day, and he prayed and gave thanks before his God, as was his custom from early days. You know, sometimes the habits we have now are things that we learn from our youth. Sometimes those are good. Sometimes those need to be modified. We probably need to be more thankful. We need to develop that habit in our life. Paul told the Philippians that when new requests are made, they should be accompanied with thanksgiving for the blessings already received. I know I've told you several times about the man from the Howe Foundation, reared by his grandmother. And he said, my grandmother always taught me in my prayers to say my thank yous before my pleases, to give thanks for the prayers that God had offered before he asked for more things. And really, I think that's pretty close to what the Apostle Paul says. Philippians 4:6, in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. When we're making more requests, there ought to be thanksgiving for the things we've already received. Full of gratitude. Our heart should be so full of gratitude that it overflows. We talked in the Bible class, how is it that God changes us? God doesn't change us by beating us three times every morning. He changes our hearts by the many things he gives to us. He floods our existence with results of his love, and that is how man's heart is changed. How do we know if our heart's changed? Well, maybe one indication is whether we stop to say thank you to God for the things he's already given us. Maybe especially when we're about to ask for more. Our heart should be so full of gratitude it overflows in genuine expressions of gratitude all the time for all things. Paul told the Ephesians that they should be giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, the theme in the Bible is, if you are grateful, say so. Paul told the Thessalonians, in everything give thanks. 1 Thessalonians 5:18. For the Christian, for all the blessings we've received, every day should be Thanksgiving Day. Our lives should be filled with Thanksgiving days. Not just being grateful days, but giving thanks days. Thanksgiving days. One of the blessings that we have is that God has provided for our salvation. And I wonder, sometimes with children, new parents, eager to please their kids, I mean, they've got all of the dolls and all the trains under the first Christmas tree. They never have to wait for anything. And I wonder sometimes if that decreases the appreciation that the child has, because they never knew life without it, they've already had it. And maybe we would make fun of the ungrateful child for having that attitude. Are we that ungrateful child when it comes to salvation? Do we ever stop to think about what our existence would be like if we didn't have that assurance of salvation? What uncertainty, maybe what dread, what terror would fill our days if we were not confident that salvation was available for us? Let us not take for granted one of the greatest blessings that God has given us, just because he gave it to us before we were smart enough to realize that we needed it. So, redemption. Who would not be grateful to God for redemption? Well, the person who is so greedy for the things of this world that they're completely not mindful of spiritual things, that person wouldn't appreciate salvation. What about those who feel so self-sufficient that they think that they don't have to, not dependent on God? And there are people like that. There are people that feel that in their judgment, their lives have been so good, you know, God's going to have to take them into heaven. There's no other choice. And what about those who are not mindful? Those who don't think about the blessings God's given to them. Blessing of salvation is one of those we need to think about and be grateful for. Forgiveness is something that we all need. Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It is sin, Isaiah 59:1-2, that separates us from that right relationship with God. That relationship that God wants to have with each one of us. The plan for having that salvation is easy. In fact, it's so easy, I think there's some people who misunderstand it, some people who probably belittle it. We have to believe, we have to repent, we have to change that heart. We have to confess. Confess Jesus for who he is. He's the Christ, the Son of God. And then be baptized. You know, baptism is a confusing topic to many people. And it's strange in a way because the Bible, 1 Peter 3:21 says, baptism saves us. I think I told you back in Virginia I had one PET321 on my license plate. 1 Peter 3:21. For all the people who say, well, the Bible doesn't say that baptism saves us. Well, yes, it does. It's a part of that process. If you've not taken advantage of that offer of salvation, don't delay. Do it today. If you understand it, do it now. If you don't fully understand it, talk to one of those of us after the services. We'll be glad to sit down and talk with you and show you additional scriptures. If there's some way that we can help you this morning, please come forward as we stand and sing.
There's a fountain free, 'tis for you and me. Let us haste, oh haste, to his free. 'Tis a fount of love from the source above, and he bids us all freely drink. Will you come to the fountain free? Will you come? 'Tis for you and me, thirsty soul. Hear the welcome call. 'Tis a fountain open for all. There's a living stream with a crystal gleam from his throne of light. Now it flows while the waters roll. Let the weary soul hear the call that pours freely. Will you come to the fountain free? Will you come? 'Tis for you and me, thirsty soul. Hear the welcome call. 'Tis a fountain open for all. There's a rock that's left, and no soul is left that may not its pure water share. 'Tis for you and me, and a stream I see. Let us hasten joyfully there. Will you come to the fountain free? Will you come? 'Tis for you and me, thirsty soul. Hear the welcome call. 'Tis a fountain open for all.
Please be seated. Our song before communion is number 167. 167, He Loves Me, is the name of the song.
Why did the Savior heavenly then come to earth below, where men his grace would not receive, because he loved me so?
There are communion kits that were available in the back. Did anybody not receive one? Please indicate so by raising your hand. You'll be served. All right, this time as Christians, we have an opportunity to think back to the time when Jesus gave his life on the cross. And remember that by partaking of the bread and the fruit of the vine. Let's pray. Father, I'm so thankful for the blessings of this life, especially the spiritual blessings that you've given us through Christ, through his death and his giving of his body on the cross. Thankful for this fitting representation of his body through this bread. Just bless us now as we take of it and remember him, his death on the cross. In Jesus' name, amen. Continue our prayer. Mindful of, again, of Jesus on the cross, how he gave his whole self, his whole life, his body and his blood on our behalf, and thankful for the blood and how it cleanses our sins and that we can be restored to you. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Again, we want to welcome you all for being with us during our morning worship. Glad you could be here with us, especially our visitors. Please stick around for a few moments afterwards and give us a chance to get to know you just a little bit. For those who brought a contribution, please place that in the plate on the table in the foyer. We ask everyone to please continue to pray for those on our prayer list. You were here early enough, you saw the list, pretty extensive list, scrolling on the screen behind me. We do have several names there with a lot of different issues. I have a few extra announcements and folks that need to be added to that list this morning. To begin with, received word that Tracy Smith's nephew, Everett, is in Santa Rosa Children's Hospital with the upper respiratory illness, so please keep him in your prayers. Also, David Usry was taken to the ER yesterday with the flu, and he's been moved into an ICU room. He is in stable condition, but I believe they're going to be working on a few different treatments to try to make his condition a little bit better. No further word on when they're going to move him into a regular room or what his status will be. Laura Nelson's mom had to be taken to the doctor either early this morning or yesterday at some point. She's asking for prayers to help the doctors figure out what's causing her blood loss. She's also asking prayers for the family's strength as they work through this. We also know that Brother Stan Stockton has been gone for 7 or 8 days now. I think he's on his way back. He's probably traveling right now or very soon and tonight and be back tomorrow. We know he'll be back tomorrow, but it's a long trip from Singapore, so he's going to be in the air pretty soon, I imagine. We'll have to ask him what things were like in the future. Men's assignments are on the track rack in the back for December, so please get a copy of that. And if you have a conflict or won't be here, please let Cliff know so we can work an alternate assignment. Also, my wife and oldest daughter, Erica and Mary, are traveling to Las Vegas this morning for Mary's first duty assignment. They left about a little bit after 6 a.m. They're going to take a couple days to drive out there And then Erica will fly back and be back on Tuesday. So pray, appreciate prayers for her having a safe trip and Mary getting established in a new city. Also, Erica's dad, Gene, came home from the hospital yesterday, which is a good sign. After his colon surgery, he's been able to eat food and start gaining strength now. So that's all positive there. The ladies' Christmas sock exchange will be on 3 December from 11 to 2 at Brenda Ratcliffe's home. Please RSVP to her today if you plan on attending. The sandwich supper slash movie night will be on December 9th at 6:30 p.m. Everyone is invited. See the bulletin board, the youth bulletin board for sign up and for more details. We're also going to be putting a few baskets together, helping our neighbor out is the program. So please see Brenda Ratcliffe if you would like to make a monetary donation. We have until the 11th of December to do that. So there's a few communities, families in our community that we're going to be helping out with that. So please see her and contribute if you're able. Just a reminder, Group 2's week to send out compassion cards will be this week for the ones that we sent out from Group 1 last week. And I'll be coordinating with the group leaders to make sure that they get the information to you. And also, there will be no visitors' meals in December to give everybody a rest as we prepare to jump into the new year in January. And the elders and deacons' breakfast for December will be on December 10th at 8:30 in the annex. And I know that was a lot of announcements. That's all we have for now. Please be standing as we have our closing song and prayer.
Our closing song will be number, number 496, The Sweet By and By.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it of all. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessings of in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. To our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise for the glorious gift of His love and the blessings that hallow our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by,
shall meet on that beautiful shore. Let us pray. Our God and Father in heaven, we're both thankful and grateful indeed for the time and opportunity you provided us this morning for our Bible study and for our worship service. We continue to pray for those on our sick list, pray for strength and encouragement. We ask that you would be with us if we leave here and always keep us in your service. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.